Welcome back, everybody. Let's talk just a little bit more about the related samples t-test. In this video, I want to go through one more example where we'll compute a related samples t. That example is specifically geared to show you that the related samples t-test is more statistically powerful than the independent samples t-test. But before we do that, let's go over the assumptions that need to be met for the related samples t-test to be valid. In general, I have two assumptions to tell you about, and then two warnings that are specific to a repeated measures design, where we measure the same people on multiple occasions. Let's talk about the assumptions first. They should sound familiar, because some assumptions are common to all different types of t-tests. The first assumption is independence of observations, and what that states is, when we collect data from someone, we want to get their response independent of any others. We don't want any other people's responses to influence the responses of our participants. I typically see that mostly as a research design issue. The way you decide how to collect your data will influence if you satisfy this assumption. So, for example, assume that you're collecting data on some really sensitive topic. If people are responding in the presence of others, they might not respond honestly. So in that situation, their response is being influenced by other people. Even when people respond privately, you still need to worry about this assumption. Because, for example, if a respondent's name is associated with their responses, they're going to know that eventually somebody's going to know how they responded. And if people know how they responded, they might not respond honestly. So sometimes we need to make sure that people have anonymity in their responses so that they know that their identity won't be known by anybody. So in other words, we have a lot of control over satisfying that assumption just based on the way we decide to collect our data. The second assumption that must be met is the normality assumption. The normality assumption states that the population of different scores must be normally distributed. Keep in mind, we don't usually have access to the entire population of scores. So how can we actually check that? The answer is we can't. But what we can do is check our sample data. If our sample of different scores is normally distributed, we can relatively safely assume that the population of different scores is normally distributed as well. And keep this in mind too. T-tests are relatively robust to violations of normality. As long as we have a decent sample size, which really just means 30 or greater, we typically don't need to worry too much about this assumption. When sample sizes are greater than 30, the distribution of all possible mean difference scores tends to be normally distributed. And as I mentioned, there are a couple warnings that are specific to repeated measures designs. Remember, repeated measures designs involve repeatedly measuring people. When we measure the same person more than once, we might have to deal with what we call carryover effects. It's probably easiest to understand carryover effects in the context of a drug study. Imagine that people are first given one drug, and then over the course of time, we measure them again after they start receiving another drug. It's possible that when we measure them in the future, they're still being influenced by that first drug. That's what a carryover effect is. Carryover effects can be positive, and they can also be negative. That first drug might help them out later on, and that first drug might hurt them later on. The bottom line is, we can't assume that that first drug stopped working, stopped having an effect, once the people started taking the second drug. It's possible that the effects of the first drug carry over. Another thing that we need to worry about with repeated measures designs is called progressive error. Progressive error is when we see changes over time, but those changes aren't due to the thing that we're testing. In other words, they're not due to the independent variable. Let me give you an example. There's plenty of research done with older drivers to see if we can help them continue to be safe drivers when on the road. So let's assume that we bring them in for some training, and the training involves them using virtual cars. In other words, in this training, they're not using real cars like they're used to. They're using high-tech equipment, and they're not used to that at all. As we measure them over time to see if they're improving in their driving ability, we might see that they actually are improving, but they might not be improving because of our training. They might be improving because they're getting more familiar with the high-tech equipment. That would be an example of progressive error. It's a change that we see over time in their driving performance, but that change is not due to our training. The change is due to their comfort level with the equipment that they're using. Progressive error can work in the opposite direction as well. Imagine those older people again, trying to improve their driving skills. If they go through training and it lasts for a long time, it's possible that as the day goes on, they become fatigued. So even though they are learning from our training, we might not see increases in their performance, and it's simply because they're becoming tired. That's another example of progressive error. In that situation, there really are changes in their driving performance, but we might not detect them because of some other issue, in this case, fatigue. All right, with the assumptions and the warnings out of our way, let's go through one more example of a related samples t-test. And through this example, I'm going to show you how powerful the related samples t-test is. In this example, I essentially want to analyze the exact same data. You can see that this data right here is exactly the same as this data right here. I want to analyze the exact same data two different ways. In the top example, we're going to assume that that data came from two completely separate groups of people. If that data came from two completely separate groups of people, the appropriate test to do is an independent samples t-test. When we do an independent samples t-test, we test to see if there are differences between the two group means. In this example, you can see that there's a 5-point difference between the group means. You can also see there's lots of variability within each group, and that's shown by a large value for the sum of squares. Remember, sum of squares is just the basis for computing variability. So, in other words, the differences that we see between the groups are relatively small, but the differences that we see within the groups are relatively large. Just to save some time, I already computed this t-test. So I computed the pooled variance, I computed the estimated standard error, and then finally the t-value. And you can see that that t-value is very, very small. There's no way that a t-value that small can ever be statistically significant. In this bottom example, we're going to analyze the exact same data. You can see we've got the exact same numbers in these two groups. But this time, let's assume that data comes from a repeated measures design, where each person is measured twice. So for example, this is the first person's score at time one, and then this is that same person's score at time two. Here's the second person's score at time one, and here's the second person's score at time two. If we're measuring the same people on two different occasions, the most appropriate test would be the related samples t. Let's switch views and then compute that together. As I was just showing you, here is our data. And we know that we need to do a related samples t-test. And here's the formula for that. It looks like we're going to need to compute the mean difference score. And then we're also going to have to compute standard error. Let's look at a formula for standard error. In order to compute the standard error, we need to know the standard deviation of the difference scores. In order to know the standard deviation of the difference scores, we need to know the variance of the difference scores. And in order to know the variance of the difference scores, we need to know the sum of squares for the difference scores. So that's where we're going to start. I've got the formula listed right here for sum of squares. According to that formula, we need to know the sum of the different scores, and then we also need to know the sum of the squared different scores. So let's go ahead and focus on those different scores. First of all, you can see where these different scores come from. We take the value at time 2, in this case 78, we subtract the value from time 1, in this case 72, and the difference is 6. Let's go ahead and compute the sum of those different scores. We'll take 6, we'll add 4, we'll add another 6, and another 4. The sum of the different scores equals 20. And while we have that in our calculator, let's just real quickly compute a mean difference score. So we'll take the sum of the different scores, and then we'll divide by the number of different scores that we have, 4. 20 divided by 4 equals 5. So the mean difference score is 5. So the sum of the different scores was equal to 20, and the sample mean difference score was equal to 5. Well, we've got the sum of d for our formula for sum of squares, but now we need the sum of d squared. So let's take every difference score and square it. 6 squared is 36, then we have 16, 36, and 16. Let's go ahead and add those up. 36 plus 16 plus 36 plus 16 equals 104. So the sum of d squared equals 104. Now we have everything that we need to compute the sum of squares of those different scores. The sum of d squared equals 104. And then we need to subtract this fraction. In the numerator, we need the sum of d squared. The sum of d is equal to 20. 20 squared is equal to 400. So this fraction would equal 400 divided by 4. So we can simplify that. That equals 104 minus 100, which equals 4. Sum of squares equals 4. Remember what I'm always telling you. Sum of squares is the basis for variability. In that first example that we did, there was a lot of variability within both those groups that we were comparing. But in this case, when we look at these different scores, there's very little variability. The sum of squares value is very small. Let's see how that affects our t-test. Let's go ahead and compute the variance of those different scores. Sum of squares equals 4. Degrees of freedom is based on the number of different scores that we have. We have 4 different scores. 4 minus 1 equals 3 degrees of freedom. So in this case, the variance of the different scores equals 1.33. Now let's compute the standard deviation. The standard deviation is simply the square root of variance. So let's key in 1.33 and hit the square root button. That equals about 1.15. Now that we know the standard deviation of the different scores, we can compute the estimated standard error of the mean different scores. We'll take that standard deviation, 1.15, and then we'll divide by the square root of the sample size, which is 4. We can simplify that. That's equivalent to 1.15 divided by 2. 1.15 divided by 2 equals about 0.58. Now we have all the information that we need to compute our t-statistic. We computed the sample mean difference score right here, and we found a value of 5. So we have 5 minus 0. Remember, this value right here is always based on the null hypothesis, and the null hypothesis states no differences from time 1 to time 2. So in other words, that value is always equal to 0. And now, according to the formula, we need to divide by the standard error, which equals 0.58. 5 divided by 0.58 equals 8.62. I'm sure you would agree 8.62 is a very large t value. We don't even need to look that up. That would be statistically significant. What I'm hoping that you see with this example is that the related samples t-test is a very powerful test. Remember, power is the probability of finding differences when they do exist. And the only way we will have a powerful test is if we end up with a relatively large t or z value. All things being equal, we just proved that the related samples t-test is more powerful than the independent samples t-test. The question that remains, though, is why? Why do we have such a big difference between those two tests? Do you remember I showed you previously that there's a lot of variability in this data? Lots of variability in this data. And when there's lots of variability in the data, the standard error that we compute will be relatively large. That value is large because we would expect big differences from one sample mean to the next. When we divide this t-test by a big number, we end up with a small result. But look at what happens when we assume that this data comes from a repeated measures design. In this case, you can see there's lots of variability in the scores at time 1, there's lots of variability in the scores at time 2, but it doesn't really matter. Because what are we analyzing? All that we're analyzing is how much did those people change. And you can see those 4 people changed in approximately the same amount. In other words, there's not much variability among the different scores. Each person essentially served as their own control group. It didn't matter where they began. It didn't matter where they ended. All that mattered was how much they changed. By analyzing the difference scores, we remove a lot of the individual differences in our data. When we reduce that variability, we also reduce our standard error. You can see the standard error in this situation is reduced significantly. So, when we compute the related samples t-test, we're dividing by a relatively small number. What happens when we divide by a small number? The answer is large. So, in summary, when we reduce the variability in our data, we also reduce the standard error, and that results in a t-test that's more sensitive to finding differences that actually exist. I know that's a lot to wrap your head around, trust me, I do, but it's also a very important lesson. The bottom line is this: repeated measures research designs are much more statistically powerful than between group research designs. So give that some thought. Well, that wraps up our discussion of the related samples t-test. The next time we get together, we're going to start talking about the one-way analysis of variance, and that's way fun. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.